I'm a scientist, and I study cancer. There are many problems in science we want to solve, but should we try to directly solve those problems here in the laboratory? Or perhaps sometimes we should be out here wandering in the woods. Maybe being in a new environment could give us a new approach, a way to solve a problem that we haven't thought of before. Today, there is much debate about the role of translational versus basic research. Translational research is that aimed directly at patient care, improving the care of patients. Basic research is more discovery, where we're exploring a concept. And we need both, and there's a place for both. But what happens if we try to solve something as difficult as cancer? And what happens if we don't know the outcome of our approach? Solving difficult problems in science requires a lot of creative freedom. And one cost of that freedom is that we make mistakes, we make missteps. And it's not always clear that what we're doing is even right. But it raises the question, should we try and cure cancer by perhaps not trying to cure cancer?
So I trained in the U.S. as an MD-PhD, which is a combined medical program and research program. But I was quite unhappy, actually, as a medical student because I felt like there was a certain constraint in medicine. There was very little room for being creative, which kind of makes sense. You don't want to be too creative when you're taking care of a patient. And so on several occasions, I tried to quit medical school, actually, because I really didn't feel like it was the right space for me. But then during my one of the summers, I did a research project and loved it. And then became really this dual physician and scientist. And so then eventually decided I would study cancer. That was a very emotional decision. Cancer affects so many people, obviously, in very meaningful ways. And I think a distant goal of all of us, of course, is to improve the care and hopefully cure those patients of a disease that destroys families in every way conceivable. But the question is, how do you get there, right? And I've begun to think about this question as, is my goal to treat people immediately, and that would be translational research, or perhaps my goal has shifted over time to be able to discover things that might treat thousands, millions of people down the road. It's very hard to think about future generations and what your discovery might not play out in treating those patients for 100, 1,000 years, perhaps. That's a really tough thing to deal with. And so the question that I think we all debate is, how do we balance those two things? Discovery just for the sake of discovery versus research that is more translational and it more quickly helps the patient.
Hey, hi.
Hey, Tammie.
Good to see
you. Thank you for coming.
Yeah.
And thanks for joining in the spirit of wandering in the woods and science. We thought we would change location and come to this play area, which is usually used for kids, but it's actually a good place for us to think about these things in science. So, and we'll have a chance to talk.
Sounds fun, let's go do it.
All right, come on. So, you know, one of the things this place reminds me of is how we approach when we're trying to solve a problem, especially a problem related to, you know, human health and human diseases. Part of discovery and discovery science is noticing things that you weren't necessarily looking for because you didn't have a goal necessarily.
So one good example of this is Fleming's discovery of antibiotics. On the morning he made the discovery, I mean, he didn't wake up and think, this is what I'm going to do today. He just happened to notice that on his bacterial plate, he had a clear area around the mold. And I think being observant to what you're not expecting is really key to discovery.
Yeah, and I think it's like seeing what you weren't looking for.
Exactly.
Yeah. So I think, you know, one of the hard things is in this more discovery type thing, just knowledge for the sake of knowledge, is that sometimes people don't believe this is important, right? They don't have faith that this is an important thing to do. And it requires a bit of dedication and bravery to stick with something that maybe people think is not going to be important or high yield.
Absolutely, and have the confidence to be at the fringes of research, not in the center. It's okay to be unfashionable, as long as your research question is good. Stick with it and take a leap of faith.
All right.
Let's do it.
Jump. Ooh, that is fun. History is littered with discoveries like this. If we use an example, you know, we now have seeming cures for sickle cell disease, a terrible disease that is incredibly painful, really has this horrible effect on people's lives. But if you look at what actually led to that, you know, seeming cure for that disease, it is decades and decades of people studying surprisingly obscure things. Yeast, Drosophila, you know, flies, things like that. And so it took this convergence of people studying really basic things about how genes are turned on and off. And then it took something completely out of left field, which was CRISPR, which was discovered as a seeming artifact in bacteria that allowed us to then engineer genomes to fix that problem in sickle cell disease. If you had told me in 1920 that this is how we're going to cure sickle disease, I would have looked at you like you're insane, right? Because you could have never in a million years have predicted the confluence of seemingly random discoveries that eventually led to that therapy. It's a remarkable example. Paradigm shifts are when we were in one place and then a set of ideas come together, and then at the end of that paradigm shift, we're in a different place. The challenge is that we're kind of blind to all the things outside of that paradigm. So maybe you could tell us a little bit about what you think paradigm and paradigm shifts are.
Yeah, well, for me, it's always been the idea of a new piece of information or knowledge that changes or contradicts what we previously understood. And a lot of the time, that can mean that something that we once thought to be true is no longer actually the case. Well, I think one of the goals in research should always be to try and facilitate that kind of creativity and draw yourself into random ideas to be able to explore them. By doing that, you create a lot more opportunities to really delve into some interesting science and maybe even some interesting discoveries.
So randomness might be a key to unlocking those blind spots. And sometimes just changing your location and changing your space, like at the top of this tower, can let you see things that you were sort of blind to before.
Absolutely. I think any refresh in your perspective is going to naturally lead to new ideas. I mean, I know myself that sometimes it takes me going out for a walk through a field to really think through a problem before I'm ready to face it in the lab.
Yeah, same with me. So my team at Oxford is pretty diverse. We work on a variety of different things, some of which are directly related to a cancer we study a lot called melanoma, which is a type of skin cancer that's had amazing translational discoveries over the past 20 years with many patients now cured of this disease. But we also have a number of people working on more basic aspects of melanocyte biology, which are the cells that give rise to melanoma. And these are seemingly, you know, very fundamental questions about the evolutionary origins of these cells, why we even have them, where they came from in evolution. Some of the things that we're thinking about come from really different fields, you know, physics and zoology and things like that. So if I try to explain why we're studying these evolutionary functions, and then we bring in all these other fields, it can seem totally disconnected from cancer. In my mind, it's super clear how these things are connected to each other. A
when students come to me and they want to work with me, I often try and spend time figuring out like what their motivation is. And it's very hard for an early career researcher to simply say, I'm going to study this simply because I think it's interesting. They actually might be interested in some really basic thing in yeast, whatever, but then they have to create a narrative about why this is translationally relevant. And I think that's a shame, right? We shouldn't force people into narratives, but in the era of pushing towards translational research, which I'm very sympathetic to translational research, it does sometimes put people in very awkward situations.
Hi, good to see you.
Hey, sorry I'm late. I was just at the top of the tower.
No problem.
So, thanks for joining me.
Do you feel like you need to justify what you're doing to others?
Yes, definitely. I think at least here and in most scientific PhDs, the whole point is to justify your project and to be able to defend it from different perspectives, not only through your data, but also your own knowledge of the topic. Mm. And I think at least maybe from a funding perspective, having just experienced going through the NIH grant process, I felt some of my creativity was definitely a bit limited by the fact that in the back of my mind, I had to think about my writing in the lens of what would a reviewer want to see. Reviewers often want to see projects that aren't overly ambitious, but are feasible, which I totally understand. And I think if you're giving a student or another researcher a large amount of money, feasibility should definitely be, you know, taken into account. But at the same time, I don't think it's necessarily bad to have a project or propose a project that's overly ambitious, because I feel like if you aren't overly ambitious, you're just limiting yourself on what you can do.
Every funding agency is under pressure to justify their existence. And the easiest way to do that is by saying, ah, this result that this person published led to this, right? So I feel a lot of pressure from funders to make what we do relevant. There is a huge, huge emphasis right now on feasibility and productivity results. It's not that I'm opposed to productivity. Actually, I'm very much in line with people being productive, i.e. publishing papers. But I don't think it's a good thing if we ask people to have a certain type of productivity in a field like cancer, for example. It's a conundrum for funders, right,
yeah,
in a lot of ways.
It's interesting that you bring that up, and just thinking about it a bit more, that funders want, you know, feasible products and how they can justify their own funding. And that's thinking very much in the present or short term.
Yeah.
When in reality, I think most of the things that people are studying in science, we're never going to solve within one lifetime or probably multiple lifetimes, right? I think if we think so short term in science, then we're not really helping the most amount of people, because we're trying to only help people now and not in the future.
I'm a scientist and I study cancer, but sometimes I go for a wander. Is there a notion that we should try to cure cancer by not trying to cure cancer? In other words, taking a very indirect path to getting to the cure for cancer. And there is no right answer. There are moments in science where we need to be very translational, very directed, but then we also need a space for people wandering in the woods. At a societal level, we need to have a conversation about what the relationship between those different approaches are. Why would we waste money allowing somebody to wander in the woods? History tells us that that wandering in the woods, both metaphorical and physical, has an outsized payback to society. It has an outsized impact down the road.